tell them again. I feel your presence.
I feel your presence.
Oh, he's moving about the building. That he's moving. Why don't you tell him that tonight? I feel you moving.
I feel you moving.
Come on, sing it. I feel you.
I feel you moving.
Oh, something about your presence.
Your presence.
It's where I long to be.
It's where I long.
Come on and tell him again. All over the place. I feel you moving.
Lord, hallelujah. Pleasant good morning to all in Radio Land. Hallelujah. In his presence is where we long to be. Praise the name of the Lord. This is the day that the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. You have been listening to Choice Gospel Radio on 92.9 FM. It's your life, it's your salvation, and it's up to you to make a choice for Jesus today. Praise the name of the Lord. Your life, your salvation, and your choice. And today, we are blessed to be in the land of the living. We thank God for the word that went forth this morning, that we are hoping at Choice Gospel Radio that you have been blessed, edified, lifted up, comforted, encouraged this morning. And as the word go forth throughout this day, we thank God for the presence of the Holy Spirit in this place, that he will continue to take full control, that whatever is done will be to the honor and glory of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Praise the name of the Lord. This is Salvation and Revelation program God brought to you by Choice Gospel Radio. Shall we pray? Father, we say thank you for another day, another time. When we come before your throne room of grace again, we say thank you, O God, for another time when we have a time to change, to grow, Lord God, into your own image, Lord Jesus. We say thank you, O God, because where there is life, there is hope. We thank you. We are in the land of the living this morning, Lord God. Lord God, we just want to say hallelujah to your name. We bless your name, O God. We give you praise and honor and glory, O God. There is no one like you, Jehovah. We thank you, O God, Father, Lord, for your blessed Holy Spirit this morning. We thank you, O God, because in him we move and we breathe and have our being, O God. We say thank you, O God, for the Holy Spirit that lead us and direct us, O God. Speak to us. Lead us into all truth. Walks with us, O God. We bless you and we thank you, O God, for sending your son Jesus to die for us, O God. And we bless your name, O God, that he did not leave us without anything, O God. He left us with his spirit, O God. So we thank you, O God, Father, for sending your son, Jesus, to die, that whosoever will may come to you. Lord, Father, we thank you for salvation. We thank you, O God, that our hope is in you. We bless you. We honor you. We magnify your name. We give you all the praise, all the honor and the glory. You deserve all the glory. You deserve all the praise. And we lift your name on high. There is no other name whereby man can be saved. So we say thank you, O God, that you're the one and only true God. We bless you and we thank you. This is the day that the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. Jesus Christ is Lord. We bless him today. We thank him and all we do today. Father, take all the glory. Amen and amen.
In your presence tonight. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Come on, help me sing it. In your presence, hallelujah.
In your presence.
Yes, Lord. It's where I long to be.
It's where I long,
where I long to be. Here in the place where worship you the more.
So I worship you the more.
For it opens up
for
a door.
Jesus,
into your presence.
Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We want to be in his presence, and in his presence there is fullness of joy. You can be in the presence of the Lord right in your bed this morning, right in your home, in your car, wherever you are. The Holy Spirit is there to lift you, to encourage you, to speak to you. Praise the name of the Lord. God is spirit, and he said, they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. And today, wherever you are, you might be driving in your car on your way to work, or you know, wherever you are, in your bathroom, in your kitchen, wherever you are, God is everywhere. Honor him, bless him, adore him, tell him how much you love him, because God loves us. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Jesus Christ is Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Today, oh God, Father, Lord God, we just lift up, oh God, all your people, wherever they are, oh God, far and near, oh God. We lift them up, oh God, to you, oh God. Father, we are living in evil and closing days, oh God. But you said, they that put their trust in you shall be like Mount Zion, they shall not be moved. So, Father, Lord God, even as we look around, oh God, signs of the times are everywhere. But, Father, oh God, you promise, oh God, Father, to shorten the days for the elect's sake. So we say, thank you, oh God, for keeping all your promises, oh God. We say, thank you, oh God, that we are in a new month, oh God, and we welcome this new month, Lord God, that, oh God, it will bring us blessings and increase and closeness with you, oh God, that we'll have a closer walk with you this month, oh God. We thank you, oh God, that you go ahead of this month, oh God, to make every crooked way straight, oh God. We thank you, oh God, in this month we'll have divine protection, as you have protected your people all during these years, oh God. I ask you, oh God, to cover each one, oh God, in your blood. Cover families, Lord God, in your blood. Cover, oh God, your ministers under your blood. Cover your children under your blood. I bring governments and leaders, oh God, those in authority. I ask you, oh God, to cover them in your blood. And I ask you, oh God, Father, Lord God, that the wisdom of God, oh God, Father, the knowledge of God, the understanding of the Holy Spirit, oh God, will prevail above every human thought in the name of Jesus. Those you have placed in authority, I put them under your blood, oh God, that Father, everything will be done in order and in decency in the name of Jesus, oh God. Father, Lord God, I bring, oh God, nations before you, oh God, where there is war and killings, oh God, rumors of war, oh God, Father, Lord God, persecutions, oh God, I bring missionaries and evangelists to you, oh God, this morning. And I ask you, oh God, that wherever they are, locate them and cover them with your blood. Keep them, oh God, Father, watch over them, oh God, provide for them, oh God. And Father, Lord God, we thank you, oh God, because who dare dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. We pray and we lift up Jerusalem this morning, O God. You say, pray for the peace of Jerusalem. So I decree peace unto Jerusalem in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Those who are sick, those who are shut in, O God, those who are depressed, those who are disappointed, O God, those who are tormented, I lift them up to you, O God, this morning, O God. O God, for remember those who are incarcerated, O God, Father, O God, some unfairly, O God, but O God, Father, those who have committed wrong, O God, that you'll have mercy and change and transform them in the name of Jesus into your own image. You came to set the captive free, O God. So I decree freedom, O God, salvation to those who are incarcerated in the name of Jesus. I decree and I declare they will have an encounter with you. And we say thank you, O God, for doing it, O God. I ask you, O God, to remember the elderly, the homeless this morning, that you will meet them at the point of their needs. And Father, oh God, even I lift up Choice Gospel Radio, oh God, your manservant, to you, Minister Straker and his wife, oh God, as a minister, oh God, the gospel, that, oh God, you provide for all their needs according to your riches in glory through Christ Jesus. Protect them, watch over them, oh God, Father, lift them in, oh Lord God. More anointing, fresh, oh God, power from your Holy Spirit, as they, oh God, Father, they do, oh God, what you have commissioned them to do in the name of Jesus. I lift every minister, oh God, who, oh God, Father, ministers at this station and all other airway, oh God, that Father, truth, oh God, uncompromised, will be given to your people, and that we'll all grow together in Jesus' name. Father, whatever comes out of my mouth today, let it be in accordance to your word. Nothing missing, nothing lacking, oh God, not my thoughts, but your word, oh God, as you send your Holy Spirit to show me, oh God, what I should say today. I decree and I declare that I too will take my portion to live a better life for you. So, Father, Lord God, fill me with your Spirit, your anointing, for another time. And I thank you for doing it. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Jesus Christ is Lord. Hallelujah. And we love you, Lord. We just want to say we love you. Hallelujah.
You, Lord, and I lift my voice.
Tell him you love him this morning.
To
he first loved you. God is love.
Take joy, my King. My King, in what you hear, let it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear. Come on, let's lift the name of the Lord high.
Sweet song in your ear, Lord. Hallelujah. Jesus Christ is Lord. Amen. This morning we continue teaching on the Protestant Reformation. Praise the name of the Lord. But before we go into that, we go into the Word. The scripture reading is taken from Galatians chapter 1. It's a scripture that's always come back to me because it's so profound, that we have to stay on course with the Word of God. And this morning, as we go into the scripture, just, you know, meditate on this scripture and see what Paul was saying to the Galatians in these few words. Praise the name of the Lord. I'm going to read from verse 6 to verse 10. Praise the name of the Lord. The Word of the Lord is already blessed, and I always advise that when the Word of the Lord is read, taught in any way, get a pen, paper, pencil, write the scripture down, because and go back and seek the Lord for yourself. Seek what the Lord is saying in his word, because many false prophets and teachers are gone out into the world to possibly deceive even the very elect. Let this not be a portion. Be wise as a serpent and be harmless as a dove. We are living in a time of serious deception. Satan has deceived the whole world. It's in the word of God. So we have to make sure that we are not partakers of his deception. Praise the name of the Lord. It reads as follows. It says, verse 6 of Galatians chapter 1, I marvel that ye are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another, but there is some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. As we said before, so say I again, now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you that he have received, let him be accursed. For do I not persuade men, or God, or do I seek to please men? For if I please men, I should not be the servant of Christ. This is the word of the Lord. Galatians chapter 1, verse 6 to 10. And I just want to make a note here to say that Paul said this twice, that if any man preach any other gospel unto you that he have received, let him be accursed. He said it in verse 9. Amen. But he said it before. He said, though in verse 8, he said, though we or any other from heaven preach any other gospel unto you, that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. So he said it in verse 8 and 9. It's a repetition. And when there's a repetition, you want to take note of it, that you make sure that you are following the right gospel. If someone preach another gospel, another philosophy, make sure that whatever is being said is you examine the word and see if it is of God. Amen. Because the Bible says, try every spirit whether they be of God. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Jesus Christ is Lord, and he wants us to be wise. He wants us to know today that we have to examine what we are doing. We are living in a time and where there's so much deception. You know, there's an increase in media. When we go back to the early church, first century church, the gospel was not that privileged, that so many people, only those who had it, were able to make use of the gospel and apply it to their life. Now we are living in a time where there is no excuse. Amen. There's no reason why you do not know what the word of God says, because it's available to us on every form and fashion. It's on the TV, television, it's on radio, it's on your iPad, it's on your cell phone, it's in the Bible, it's on everywhere, it's on tracks. There is no reason why you cannot get the word of God and say, yeah, let me examine for myself. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. The word of God says, study to show yourself approved. Amen. He gave Joshua an instruction that, you know, to study the word day and night so that you will make your way prosperous and that you will have good success. Amen. So there it is. Praise the name of the Lord. So Romans chapter 1, I'm going to read a little bit in Romans chapter 1. Praise the name of the Lord. Romans chapter 1. And I'm going to read from verse 1. It said, Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God, which he had promised afore by his prophets in the holy scriptures, concerning his son Jesus Christ our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh, and declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead, by whom we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith among all nations for his name, among whom are ye also the called of Jesus Christ. To all that be in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. First, I thank my God through Christ Jesus for you all, that your faith is spoken of throughout the whole world. For God is my witness, whom I serve with my spirit in the gospel of his Son, that without ceasing I make mention of you in always in my prayer, making requests, if by any means now at length I might have a prosperous journey by the will of God to come unto you. For I long to see you, that I may impart unto you some spiritual gift, to the end which may be established, that is, that I may be comforted together with you by the mutual faith both of you and me. Now I would not have you ignorant, brethren, that oftentimes I purpose to come unto you, but was led hitherto, that I might have some fruit among you also, even as among other Gentiles. I am a debtor both to the Greek and to the barbarians, both to the wise and to the unwise. So as much as me is, I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are at Rome also. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is a power of God unto salvation, to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. Praise the name of the Lord. As it is written, the just shall live by faith. Romans 1:17. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. We just singing that I love you, Lord. Just make this be your song today, that you love the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. And this morning I will be going into some scriptures and let the Holy Spirit work and see what he's saying to you concerning where we are at. Are we in the Word of God? Are we living the Word of God? Where are the areas in our lives that need to be changed, transformed? You know, and are we making that effort to find out the truth of what God requires of us? Amen. And when we're speaking about the Protestant Reformation, we're talking about reform and change that took place in Europe that affected the whole world, the gospel, as we see in the history of the church. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the Lord. And I just want to, before I go into the teaching, I just want to encourage someone out there who do not know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, and you're struggling with what, you know, what is Jesus about? You know, so many different denominations, so many different churches, and you do not know which one to go to, what to do. He wants you to come to him. Jesus Christ wants you to come to him first. Before you go into any building, he wants you to come and give your life to him. You can give your life to him right now in your bed, in your home. The Bible says, whosoever call on the name of Jesus, he would not ignore you. They shall be saved. He said, call upon me while I'm near, while he can answer you. You know, because the Spirit of the Lord will not always strive in man. So God wants you to know this morning that he loves you. And he wants you to love him back, but you must be born again. He wants you to direct you, to lead you, to bring you into his fullness. But you are looking at what this church is doing and what this Christian is doing. It's not going to help you, because when you stand in front of Holy God, you cannot give the excuse, well, you know, the Catholic Church was doing this, or the Methodist Church was doing this, or the Pentecostals were doing this. You're going to stand in front of a holy God and give account for what you have done with your life. Are you born again? Are you washed in the blood of Jesus? Are all your sins forgiven? Have you repented? Have you been baptized? Have you received the gift of the Holy Spirit? Were you led by the Holy Spirit, or were you led by man? These are the things that you're going to have to stand in front of a holy God. And this is how our lives are going to be judged by. Are you born again? Did you receive my son, or did you reject him? Have you used excuse after excuse why you're not going to give your life to Christ, because you're looking at this one or this church? It is not going to stand before a holy God. He said it's appointed unto man just one time to die, and after death there is judgment. He said, I place before you life and death. And he gave us the answer, choose life. Today, if you do not know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, now is the accepted time. All you have to do is ask Christ into your life. You heard so many messages before. I'm speaking to someone who have been listening. They've not just the Choice Gospel Radio, but you have listening to televangelists. You have been listening to TBN and other stations. And you have heard the Word of God, but still you have not surrendered your heart to Jesus Christ. What are you waiting for? Time belongs in the hand of God. We do not know when he's going to take us out of this world. And you do not want to stand in front of God and he says to you, you did not accept my son. You rejected me, so I reject you. You do not want to hear, depart from me, I never know you. So you got to give your life to Christ. That's my plea today. Surrender your heart to Jesus. All it needs to you need to do is say, yes, Jesus Christ, you are truly the only begotten Son of the living God. And there's no other way in which I can come to you, Father. And you are the way. I am a sinner. That's your confession. We are all sinners and we are saved by God's grace. I am a sinner and only I believe that Jesus Christ is the only one that can forgive my sins, and because he took death away when he went to the cross of Calvary and he died for my sins. Amen. And I accept him as my personal Lord and Savior, and I want to have a personal relationship with him when I could come and I can talk with him. I can tell him anything I want to share with him, and he becomes your friend, your brother, your father, your mother, the most important person in your life. Don't you want that relationship? Don't you want to know there's a supernatural being that watches over you, that walks with you, that talks with you, that lives inside of you? That's a gift. That's the biggest present. That's the biggest gift you can ever have in your life. It's not about gold. It's more precious than silver. There's nothing more precious than your soul salvation. Think on those things. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. So we were teaching on the Reformation, and I'm going to go into it a little more of it. It's going to be for a while, but I'm going to share some important scriptures that, you know, if you can't get a pen, pencil, take the scripture down, go search it yourself. And just to recap a little bit for someone who have tuned in and was not able to listen to the broadcast on those that went before Wednesday and the previous Saturday, we're speaking on the Protestant Reformation. And what the Protestant Reformation was a change that took place when the early church had some from the early church that was started in the time of Peter, according to Acts chapter 2, some have departed and aligned themselves with the Roman government because of different problems in the church. And then that gave rise to the Catholic Church, which the Catholic means universal. So now we have this quote-unquote universal church who is headed by the Pope, you know, and under the Pope we have cardinals and bishops. Now, what happened was that there was an alliance between church and state, where the church, those who are departed and, you know, started this new religion, Catholicism, they used the model of the Roman government to launch out this church. Amen. And God had given us a blueprint for his church. He said, you know, to Peter, he said, upon this rock I build my church, and the gates of hell shall not, you know, prevail against it. Amen. We see that the church model that was taken, that was adopted by the Catholic Church, was similar to the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire consists of an emperor as head. The Catholic Church had a pope as the head. Then they had advisors as another level, and then the Roman Catholic Church chose cardinals on that level as of advisors. Then they had the governors after the Roman government model, and then the Catholic Church ordained bishops. Amen. So they used that same model to establish a new religion, the Catholic Church, with its own sets of ideologies that were not in line with the Word of God, some very important aspect of what God has said in his Word, they were not observed by this new religion, Catholic Church. They came up with their own belief system. And this man, Martin Luther, he was a monk, and he was studying and meditating and trying to get it right with God. But because of, you know, he always feel that he didn't do enough, to his sins was not forgiven enough, because he was always feeling guilty. So he keeps searching the scripture, trying to get it right with God. He was a lawyer, but he felt this call to go into that set, you know. So he went and became a monk, amen, M-O-N-K. So now he, this Martin Luther, because of his thirst and his zealousness for truth, he searched the scripture, trying to find out, you know, what is it that was missing, because some of the things that the Catholic Church was doing, he was not, you know, in agreement with what they were doing. They had a big problem in the Catholic Church where they were doing things that did not line up with the Word of God. One of the things that he was against was indulgences, something that the Catholic Church adopted. It's an indulgence is a way of decreasing or reducing the amount of punishment one has to undergo for sin. So they would give you a paper saying, okay, then, well, the paper might read, you know, I'm just using this like an example. You have been forgiven of your sins, and you know, you have paid the price to enter heaven, something like that. It would give you some sort of decree in terms of that you have made it into heaven. So now the Catholic Church now was deciding who goes to heaven and who goes to hell. So there is this place that they created, this alternate place called purgatory, which, you know, if you didn't make it too right or you had some sins, you can, you know, stay in that place and you pay this money that you can get yourself cleaned up, so that, you know, you spend some time there and then you transition into heaven. This was not biblical. And Martin Luther had a problem with these indulgences because they were selling them for profit, for money. People were coming and buying this piece of paper and thinking that they're buying their way into their salvation. And so he searched the scriptures. And when he searched the scriptures, he came up with this. He happened to bounce upon this scripture that Paul wrote in Romans chapter 1 verse 17, which says, "For wherewith therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith." That scripture verse transformed Martin Luther's life. Amen. He just opened up his spiritual awareness that he knew for sure now that he could not comply and conform with the lies and the discrepancies of the Catholic Church. So he wrote all everything that he had concerns about, and it was 95 theses, meaning 95 different things that he was not in agreement with. He wrote them on a paper and stuck it at the church door in Gettysburg, and he put that paper there so that people, that when they opened the church, they saw that paper and all the things. Eventually he was placed in front of a council, and he stood up for what he believed. He did not refrain. He did not take back his word. He said, "No, I am not in agreement with the things that are going on in the Catholic Church." Praise the name of the Lord. He stood up for righteousness. And what I'm trying to say here is that Martin Luther was just one man, but there was others who went before him, like Wycliffe and Hurst. There were two, theologians and monks who went before him, and they died. They were burnt. John Wycliffe, you know, this was one of the pioneers who wanted those reform. He was burnt. And even his bones was dug up, and they burnt it even after he was dead. That's to tell you the kind of persecution that the church was undergoing at that time for righteousness' sake. We have the opportunities that we can still stand up for the things of God without being burnt to death. In some countries, men and women are being burnt to death, beheaded for their faith. And we still have the opportunity to stand up for Jesus. Amen. So this, the first thing that, you know, he was really, really against was those indulgences, I would say, because they was telling the people indirectly or directly that you can pay your way or buy your way into eternity, that the church control your salvation. So when he saw that scripture, the just shall live by faith, he knew no way that could he continue under those principles. And we have to make a stand for righteousness. We have to know this is wrong and stand up for the truth. The Bible says, if you deny me, I'm going to deny you in front of my Father. And it's not just about just denying his name and saying, no, I don't know you, Jesus. But you can deny him by not even standing up for what he believes in, what he stands for. Amen. You come in line with things that is not God and not according to the word of God. Martin Luther made a decision. No, I am not going to do that. I am not compromising with that which does not belong to God. You know, God did not say that he lives by the word alone. That's the word that's in the word of God. This was not biblical. The people at that time did not have Bibles like now. So whatever the priests said, this is what they believe in. Amen. So when the person received an indulgence, they had to perform a particular action. It might be a prayer, a repeated prayer. They have to say to make that atonement for their sin, a performance of a special good work or something, or visit a particular place. We don't have, you know, these were all bondages that was placed on the people. Amen. The Middle Age was full of those things that it became so commercialized that it became a problem even with the church, that the church wanted to stop it, I guess, but it couldn't because it was so much rooted and so widespread. Amen. The Catholic Church at that time, you know, was controlling the kings and queens of Europe. They controlled the economic, their economics. They controlled the political arena, the social environment. They were responsible for education, for charity, for they had one third of land, so they had a very powerful, they were a very powerful church, amen. But when Martin Luther, one man came against such a powerful organization, you know that then now his life will be on the line. And God is saying to us this morning, you know, that you know to reign with him. You know, we must suffer with him. It have times when we have to make a stand and say, no, this is wrong. You know, and like Esther says, you know, I'm going to see the king. If I perish, I perish. And when we look at the scripture, we see that, you know, so many things have been watered down in the word of God from that time when Martin Luther had that declaration. He said, no, everything is by faith alone, is by God alone, is by salvation alone, you know. And he had certain things that he said, no, this is what it is, and I'm not going to change, I'm not going to back down, I'm not going to move away out of that protest, you know, Protestant Reformation. When we break it down, it's protest. They protested, yes. They did not conform. They protested when they saw something was wrong. And Reformation means change came about as a result of the protest that took place. Protestant Reformation. So the word Protestant Reformation comes from the root word protest, protest, to protest, meaning I am not conforming with this. I'm against this. Reformation, a change that came about because people stood up and say, no, this is not right. So this is what happened. After that, the rise of other denominations. We have Lutheran, Calvinism, Puritanism, the Church of England, all came out. Some of them had good intentions and some of them had, you know, selfish motives. Amen. Paul warned the church before he left. He said, many savage wolves will come in among you. And even from among yourself, he said it in Acts 20, verse 29 and 30. He said, for I know this, that after my departure, savage wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. Also from among yourselves, men will rise, speaking perverse things to draw away the disciples after themselves. We see men and women of God drawing people to themselves. They want the glory to be on them rather to be given to Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit gives glory
to the Son of God. Amen. But when you have, if we are not led by the Holy Spirit, we will fall into the same thing that happened in the early church. Amen. After the early church was started, not in the early church, but those who moved away and gave rise. So now we have over 41 going, and it's climbing, over 41,000 different denominations arising from Christianity. Why? Because we have to ask the question, was this led by the power of the Holy Spirit? Because the Bible says, the Bible says that when the church was started, praise the name of the Lord, that God gave certain instructions to those he entrusted with his word, Paul being one of them. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. And because Paul stood up against so many things that was in the church, now this Martin Luther stood up against all those things that was going on in that whole dynasty of Catholic, the Catholic Church. So he said, listen, you know, that the church that I give, you know, Christ is the head of the church. And as Christ is the head, we are the body. So we must follow the head. So what, as leaders in the church and for followers in the body of Christ, we have to go back to what the Word of God says. We go back to that old time religion, that thing that God said in his word to the apostles. This is what I said. And this is why when Peter preached the word of God, 3,000 people came into Christ. They said, what must we do to be saved? And gave them the blueprint in Acts chapter 2. As we see it in verse 37, 38, 39, we see he said, you must repent, and we must be saved, you must be baptized in the name of Jesus. You must, you know, he said to them that they would receive the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit is not just for them, but for even to those that are afar, meaning that there are some people who are going to give their life to Christ in distant lands, faraway places, and his promise is given to them also. Praise the name of the Lord. Different cultures, different traditions, different people will come into Christ and know that Jesus Christ is Lord. So this was the requirement to be saved. Now the Catholic Church is saying all these things you're going to start doing, infant baptism and sprinkling of water on the head, which was not, you know, what God wanted. He said you must be immersed because he was immersed in water. Praise the name of the Lord. They started having the word of God given in Latin, so the people was not able to really understand what is going on, because if you didn't speak Latin, you wouldn't understand a lot of things. Then, you know, they had what you call, you know, the catechism. All those things came up with the Pope becoming the infallible voice of the church, meaning that he's becoming like God on earth. It is not biblical. So these are the things that Martin Luther stood up against. So he came up to the Catholic Church and he said, listen, these are these five things that, you know, there's five major things that I think that, you know, you need to change. He didn't want to destroy the church. He wanted to reform the church. And they did not accept what he was saying. So that gave rise to all the other religions that came out, because others came out and disputed or protested the things that was going on in the Catholic Church. They developed what you call the five solas, S-O-L-A-S. It's Latin for alone, the five alone, amen, which was the five important points of the Bible's teaching that separated Protestantism from Catholicism, amen. What I'm saying is that these five things gave a distinction into what it, as to what Catholic believe and what, you know, those new group of people that came out of the Catholic Church, the Protestant, believe. And the first thing, one of the first one, was scripture alone. Amen. Martin Luther believed that only the scripture is the word of God that we should believe. The Bible alone is the only authority. And second, if you have your Bibles and you turn to 2 Timothy chapter 3, praise the name of the Lord, we see that, you know, the word of God says it. He was not going by what man says now. He was going by what God word says. In 2 Timothy, praise the name of the Lord, if you have your Bibles, 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 16 and 17, praise the name of the Lord, it says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Amen. So this is what he stood on, that all scriptures, not just some scriptures. And it's in 1 Thessalonians 2, verse 13, praise the name of the Lord. In 1 Thessalonians 2 and verse 13, another thing he said, he refused to accept the authority of the popes and the council because they were not in accordance with even each other, much less to be in accordance with the word of God. Amen. And 1 Thessalonians 2 and verse 13 says, for this cause also thank we God without ceasing, because when we received the word of God, which we heard of us, we receive it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth the word of God, which effectually worketh also in you that believe. Amen. He's saying that the word of God is not about man. This is what God's word says. It is the truth, the word of God. So Martin Luther refused to accept the word of the Pope, that the Pope is infallible. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. I'm just trying to go point by point as to how this came about and how he was in line with what the word of God says that he was trying to change. And you who might be in a ministry, or you might be doing something that is outside of the word of God because of some old teaching that you have learned before you gave your life to Christ, or that you saw that your parents did, your grandparents conformed, and it was handed down to you. You need to take a step backwards and say, let me stand still and ask myself, is this what God wants me to do? Is this in line with the word of God? Is this in the gospel of Jesus Christ? Is this another gospel that I'm following? You know, am I following men as well as God at the same time? The Bible says a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Amen. He was told to take back these words that you said. You know, we don't want you to say those things. I want you to recant your words. But he said no. You know, he cannot and will not go against his conscience. We cannot go against our conscience either. If there is something that is happening in your place of worship, or if there is something that you are doing that you feel uncomfortable with, you know, it's being passed down to you from generation, and you know this thing is wrong. Amen. And you're going against your conscience because something in you is saying this thing is wrong. Amen. In Matthew, if you can turn your Bible to Matthew chapter 10, praise the name of the Lord. Matthew chapter 10 and verse 33. Sometimes we tend to go along to get along, but the Bible says that, you know, a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. So we don't want to be caught up with being double-minded. I want to please my parents. I want to please my culture. I want to please my people. I want to please my pastor, my bishop, my prophet. When you know that thing is wrong, then you have a responsibility to be accountable for yourself. And the Bible says if you find someone else in fault, who are strong should, you know, encourage that one. So it's up to you. You have a choice. It's your life, your salvation, your choice when you made that choice. But when you make that choice, you need to stand up for what is right. Praise the name of the Lord. Matthew chapter 10 and verse 33 says, it said, but whosoever shall deny me before men, him will I also deny before my Father which is in heaven. Martin Luther did not deny Christ when he stood up to that council, to that Pope, and to that minister of the Catholic Church. He did not deny his belief. He said, no, he cannot and will not go against his conscience. Matthew 10:33, he said, if you deny me, I'm going to deny you. He stood up for righteousness. And it was in a time. He didn't have a lawyer to come and speak for him. He didn't have a court-appointed lawyer to come and stand in the gap for him. He stood up on the word of God. And that scripture that he read, the just shall live by faith, you know, he exercised that faith in God and he lived by that word and stood up for what was right. All our faith should be in God, completely anchored in God. David wrote about total and complete faith in God. In Psalms chapter 7 verse 1, he said, oh my God, in thee do I put my trust. Save me from them that persecute me and deliver me. Put your trust in God today. I'm going to end right there. I need, you know, this teaching is going to continue for maybe next week and a couple weeks ahead, where we will look in and see what Martin Luther and those who went before us, they paid a price for what we have today. But what we have today, the Word of God, you know, we have to make sure that we stand on the truth of the Word of God. Don't compromise to get along. Don't go along to get along. Amen. Stand on the Word of God. Go read your Bible yourself. Search as Martin Luther did. And make sure you're following what Christ left behind for his church. Praise the name of the Lord. Father, Lord God, we thank you for your word. We bless you. We praise your name, O God, that someone will say, yes, Jesus Christ is Lord today. Someone will be blessed today. And we give you all the praise and the honor and the glory, that we all self-examine and see whether we are in the faith. This is Choice Gospel Radio. Give your heart to Jesus today. He's waiting on you. Praise the name of the Lord. Trust him. Get into the truth of the word and live by his word, not man's word. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah.
Jesus, in moments like these, I lift up my hands. I lift up my hands to the Lord.
Jesus Christ is Lord, and we say thank you, God, for the word today. As the word go forth, may it be a blessing to you, and may you meditate, think. Martin Luther meditated on what he read. He was searching the scriptures, and many times, you know, we get caught up in things because we do not search the scripture ourselves. Search the scripture and try every spirit. We are living in terrible times of deception. Amen. Satan trying to deceive even the very elect. Let make your election sure. If you're this station has been a blessing to you, you can write us at Choice Gospel Radio, P.O. Box 30016, Brooklyn, New York, 11203. We thank you for all your support in prayer and whatever way that the Holy Spirit lead you. We love you. And if you have anything that you'd like to share, we can be reached at 347-663-8638. Again, 347-663-8638. 347-663-8638. We hope we have been a blessing to you, and we want to extend our love to you by reaching out to you whenever you have the time to. You can reach out at any time. We will get back to you at some point. God bless you, and continue to listen to Choice Gospel Radio. Praise the name of the Lord.
Worthy to be worthy.